This screencast will discuss chemical potential for multi-component systems. And the importance of chemical potential is that it tells us the direction of mass transfer because molecules will move from high chemical potential to low chemical potential. Let's look at an example to make this clear. We start off with a beaker that contains water and iodine. So we've dissolved iodine in water. This mixture is now brown. And what we're going to do is add ether to this mixture. Ether is less dense, so it'll be on the top phase. The ether and water do not mix significantly, so we have a two-phase system. We have water on the bottom and ether on the top. And then what we see is the ether becomes brown because the iodine dissolves in the ether, leaves the water, and the water becomes clear again. And so we had mass transfer that's against the concentration gradients. As the iodine is depleted from the water and goes in the ether, we'll have a lower concentration of iodine in the water, but the chemical potential will still be higher, so the iodine will continue to move until the chemical potential in the water is equal to the chemical potential in the ether. So this is the chemical potential for the iodine. That's then our criteria for equilibrium, and we can move against the concentration gradient. So I've written equations for chemical potential. This is the chemical potential of component I in the mixture. This is the single component chemical potential for that component. And then the activity, and this is for liquid phase, where we typically end up using activity, it's a mole fraction of the component and the activity coefficient, which depends on what other species are present. If instead we're in gas phase, we typically use fugacity, where our standard state is pure component ideal gas at 1 bar. So this units for fugacity must be in bar for this equation to be meaningful. And if it were an ideal gas mixture, then we can replace the fugacity by the partial pressure. So this is the partial pressure of species I, and you can see the chemical potential depends on the log of the pressure. Now, it's worth writing down definition of chemical potential, and that's the partial derivative of the total Gibbs free energy of a mixture with respect to the number of moles of component I, constant temperature, constant pressure, and constant moles of all the other species. It also is equal to the partial of the total internal energy respect to the number of moles of component I, but now at constant entropy, volume, and moles of all the other species. So let's look at chemical reactions, and we're going to define chemical potential is zero for the stable form of the element. Chemical potential scale is arbitrary, so this is, if you like, our reference state. The idea is if we had hydrogen gas standard conditions, or if we had carbon solid, its chemical potential would be zero. And then we could look at a chemical reaction. So what I've done is list the reaction from this reference at the beginning of the screencast, and listed from the table they have of the chemical potentials for each of these components. So the first thing to note is that these values are all negative, and that's because the species form, so the elements have chemical potential of zero. We go to lower chemical potentials, meaning that we expect the compound to have a lower chemical potential than the pure components. And if we add these together, on the left side is -1291. This is kilojoules per mole. On the right side is -1366 kilojoules per mole. This is for 1 mole of each species standard conditions. And what this says is we expect reaction in this direction to get to equilibrium. Namely, we go to lower chemical potential. The idea of lower chemical potential, the driving force is chemical potential. And so just like for the phase change, we can look at reactions and determine which direction equilibrium reaction will take place. It doesn't tell us anything about the speed, but it tells us the direction.